Another episode of Come On Guy with Mike Fabeman. I have an awesome, awesome new friend and comedian on the show today, Thea Vidal.
Hi,
did I say that? Am I saying that correct?
Vidal, yes.
Vidal. Very, very, it was good to meet you on the ship, by the way.
Thank you.
Because, you know, you always go on these ships and you don't know who you're going to work
with.
Yeah,
you don't know what devil may come.
You don't know if they're going to be funny. You don't know if they're going to be cool. And luckily on this ship, I met both you and Al, and Al's cool as hell. And you've known Al for...
I've known Al for 30 years, so... Yeah. I knew exactly what he was going to do.
Yeah. So when you said you knew Al, did you used to do the clubs with him in New York? And
yeah, we did clubs all over the country. We drove all over the country.
Together?
Not always, but we've ridden or met up at clubs. And in the old days, sometimes we had to stay in the condo. Or you stayed with some friends that you knew.
Yeah.
I personally can pretty much get along with anybody.
Yeah.
As long as you don't start no shit. That's all I'm saying.
Well, comedians do have a reputation to either be really cool or real assholes.
Well, there's quite a few assholes out there. I'm sure
you've seen a few.
I've seen a few of them. And they're not all men. And that's the scary part. Because I'll knock a bitch out. I won't. You know, it's hard to knock a man out. But you know.
Can try.
It's the women that are so mean. And to this day, there's one woman out there. I don't know if she realizes how many feelings that she's hurt.
Oh, really?
How mean she has been. I don't think Diane Ford knows that.
Wow.
I do not think
Why do you think she's like that though? Why do you think that? You don't have to be a jerk to get ahead.
Okay. Well, she was hot. She was hot.
Mm.
Okay. And make no bones about it, she was hot. But for some reason, she just was mean-spirited. Mm. And I didn't understand that because I'd never done anything to her. But then this is how quick God worked. We were in Vegas, and she had married a drummer or some in a rock band, and she kept calling him, and he wasn't answering, and I could see the panic women get in their eyes where they want to cry.
Yeah.
Why is he doing this to me? That kind of thing. And now, remember, I don't know if I tell you, she had been mean to me about a few hours ago. But I told her, I said, Diane, baby, you know, musicians are just like comedians. They get with their friends and they start, you know, singing and playing instruments and stuff, and he probably just lost track of time.
Yeah.
He's gonna call you, I promise he will. You think so? Yeah, I think so. Now, I could have gave it a shit. I could have said a whole lot of ugly shit.
Yeah.
I could have said, no, that motherfucker ain't gonna call you. He probably hiding to get away from your funky ass. But my heart wouldn't let me do that.
Yeah.
Because she was already in despair behind this man. And I take it that she really loved it.
Yeah.
You know,
do you think this industry takes a lot out of people?
I think this industry takes a lot of... It takes a special kind of man to be with a woman that's in this industry.
Yeah.
And it equally takes a special kind of woman to be with a man in this industry. Because... I think men, especially if you're a woman, make more money than you make. It starts to do something to you. Men say it doesn't bother them, but it does.
I'm sure. It's hard not to be the breadwinner.
You make money, but you don't make the money she makes.
Mm.
And you got to catch up.
Hard on the psyche, huh?
Okay. And a lot of men, women, it's hard for them because you can only imagine what your husband is out here doing.
Yeah.
What is he out here doing? Is he being faithful to me? Is he being remembering I love him?
Yeah.
Is he remember I'm busting my ass out here working to try to make ends meet so he can pursue his dream? See, it's a lot.
Have you had problems with that before, where you're away so much and that you just not insecure, but you're worried about what your man's doing at home?
Of course.
Yeah.
Of course you get insecure. You start to go, wait a minute. I make the money. If he won't leave, let him leave. But he gonna leave with what he came with. A lot of women now are starting to take their men with them. And that's a good idea. But if your man is with you, he's not working. And the Bible says a man that don't work don't eat. And the man begins to feel like he's less than. Because really, how much help could you be?
Yeah.
To your wife? I'm old school.
I want to provide.
Some men don't want to provide. These young men don't want to provide.
These young men want a good luck piece. A free ride.
They want a sugar mama.
Yeah.
And they had to sugar their ass somewhere else.
I want to get back to what you were saying earlier about how some women are really bad to each other in comedy, right?
There are some women that are ruthless.
Yeah, I'm wondering why, though, because the women complain a lot about the way that men treated them in comedy, which I see all the time and I hate. But I'm just wondering why women would be mean to other women, knowing the fact that how hard this industry is and how hard it is as a woman in comedy.
Because fear dictates you might get ahead of me.
Yeah.
And that's so silly. Because we need each other. Obviously, people are not paying attention. There is women power.
Hell yeah.
Look how quick we got rid of Trump.
Yeah.
We was going, we were serious about that. We was in line.
Yeah.
Okay. You going. That's the same kind of energy we need to have. But we need to have the right women in place to bring us all together.
Yeah.
And what I see is the wrong women in place. The alleged queens or whatever they call themselves. It can't be about you. It has to be about the greater good.
Yeah.
It has to be about, we have to have a way that we all meet up and talk about our problems and not just talk about you and what you doing. It ain't always all about you.
Mm-hmm.
And stop being so... You know one thing I envy men for? Y'all, you can get a bunch of different men together. And they can agree to disagree. And not one of them bastards will go, you just jealous. Not one of y'all.
Yeah.
You never go, you just jealous. No. They say, okay, we agree to disagree. How about this? How about we do this? Okay? Women for some reason.
We
can't get on that same page.
Huh.
And this business, she's old. Oh, she's fat. Oh, she doesn't look like me. Oh, her skin's too dark. Oh, shit. You know, it's like... Everybody has something to bring to the table.
100%.
And if women could stick together like the women in politics did,
mm-hmm.
we could be going somewhere.
Yeah. So you think you guys are holding each other back, huh? You think women are holding each other back?
I think women in this industry are holding each other back. I can tell you one thing. All of the white women are working together.
Yeah?
Yep. my sisters, I don't know what the fuck is wrong with us. I have to be honest. We need to be together.
Yeah.
But hold on. We need our white sisters and our Latin sisters and our Asian sisters. They could teach us things that we don't know. We all have something to teach each other, but nobody wants to listen.
It's the competitiveness, isn't it?
It's the competitiveness. But that, you know what else the sad part of it is? Men are behind it.
You think so?
Oh, yeah. Men been keeping women smack? At... Women been, men been keeping women at each other's throats for years.
Huh. You think it's strategic or you think it's just kind of inherent?
I think it's strategic. Because as long as... think about it. As long as I keep you... Pick, 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 pick. You can't see what I'm doing behind my hands. And that's the sad part.
Yeah.
You know, if women could, if women in politics could stop for a minute and go, what's the greater good? Do you want this thing in the White House?
Right.
Or do you want this thing in the White House? It's not, it's enough of us to say who is. It's not, it may not be... enough of us to say who, this sounds weird. It may not be enough of us to say who is the president, but it's enough of us to say who ain't gonna be president.
Right.
So you'll have to get someone else.
Right.
I believe Biden ain't gonna be here next year. And in 22, you know, just,
we're that close to having a female president right now.
Please, Lord, let Michelle Obama run, please.
We're talking about that.
I know.
If she was to run, man, would that be competitive?
That would be so funny. That would be so funny.
She would take no prisoners.
She know all your business.
Oh, yeah, especially on the Democratic
side. You, some of y'all going to have to go. Pelosi, you going to have to go. No, I mean, everybody, all the old guard, Republicans and Democrats, it's time for you old motherfuckers to get the fuck on. It's just time. It's time to go. It's time to go. We need some new blood, some young blood, because, you know, I'm sure Miss Lindsey Graham want to wear her Louboutins in peace without getting caught. I'm sure Mitch McConnell want to scratch his nuts at his house. You know, I'm just, I'm sure, you know what? I'm sure that they want to be able to hold their head up before they leave this earth and say, I did the right thing. And Mike Pence, I don't know what's wrong with him. If you tried to have me killed, I think I pretty much fucking quit fucking around with you. We can't be friends no more. My mama wouldn't let me play with you no more. I mean, it's just like, if your child is a bad child and your child is always pushing my child down, two things gonna happen. Either my child gonna stand up and punch you back, or I'm gonna come over there and tell your mama, and if she get down wrong, I'm gonna punch her. Okay? Mike, I don't know what he's thinking. This is not the way to the presidency.
No, I think he got mixed up into a wrong situation that he didn't know how to get out of gracefully.
I mean, it looks so bad.
Look bad, especially during the pandemic. They,
oh my God.
They were not heroes.
They were not the heroes. And and I blame Trump, because you shouldn't have dismantled the pandemic team.
Yeah.
I mean, Obama had a pandemic team. You dismantled it just because he was black. Even your own attorney, Mike Cohen, said his sole thing against Obama is he's black. So that makes you a racist, and we can't have a racist in the White House.
No, although
we've had so many to prove. We've had so many prior, but still.
Yeah, different time, but not as blatant and as divisive.
I do give President Johnson credit. He did. He said, I can't ask them people to go over there and fight in Vietnam and not let them vote, not let them be human. That shit's got to suck. His conscience got the best of him.
And you wish that would happen to some others.
Well, the rest would have to have conscience.
Right.
You know.
They're all sociopathic.
Some of y'all, I don't even know what your mama did your mama not stir your oatmeal counterclockwise?
I think it has to do with power.
What the fuck?
I think that power is intoxicating and they just cannot get enough of it.
I know, but it...
Look at Pelosi. She's been in there forever. Retire. She can't. The power, the publicity, the money.
It's like, you already got money.
You got everything.
If you don't take your old wrinkled... who's that heifer that... Gloria Vanderbilt looking ass out of here. Get your ass on away from me and go sit on a rocking chair.
Exactly.
Sit down somewhere. Sit down, Pelosi. I ain't playing with you, bitch. I mean, she's sitting there. I'm just counting the wrinkles. And I'm just saying.
Just let it go. Damn.
Okay, look. I mean, this is what I would say to her. Miss Pelosi, I mean, for the most part, I have respect for you. Really, I do. I know it's hard to believe. I have respect for you, but I have respect for you. But if you don't get, I swear for God, I put my hand on the Holy Bible. If you don't get your ass out this office, I swear for God. I'm going to drag your ass in a wheelchair out of here. I swear to God, because you just evil bitch. You got to go. You know, I mean, it's time. Don't you want to see your grandchildren?
It's time.
I mean, don't you want to play with your grandbabies and your great-great-great-grandbabies?
I mean.
I don't even know how old you are. 400? I don't know. You remember slavery?
She does.
That's an old bitch. I swear to God. That bitch know Uncle Ben. I swear.
She's a vampire. She's been around for
I just
minute.
Like, I don't know. I'm just saying.
Uncle Ben.
I'm just saying, at some point, you know, some point, it's not that we don't think you're smart. We just don't think you're as smart as you once were.
Right.
And everybody gets older, and you—
out of the loop. Just out of the loop. Not the finger on the pulse.
It's not that we don't love you, Nancy. I'm speaking to you as one woman, in case you listener or one of your minions is listening. And I'm speaking from a point of being a woman, a God-fearing woman. Look here. Miss Thea love you. Millions of women love you, but it's time now. It's time.
Yeah.
You've done everything you could do, and we are grateful what you have done well, and we forgive you for the shit you fucked up.
Yeah.
But you gotta go.
Yep. You've got your millions, hundreds of millions.
You've got your hundreds of millions. How much money do you need, baby? How much money do you need?
I know.
Because at this point now, you're just being greedy.
Yeah.
You're turning into a succubus.
Yeah.
And nobody likes a succubus.
Nobody. And her husband's rich too. And her cousins.
Don't you want to fuck your husband?
Yeah.
Let me do that. How about, let's go from that angle. Don't you want to give your husband some punani?
Wouldn't that be nice?
Wouldn't it be nice?
90 years.
Y'all been together for a long time. Wouldn't you like to give your husband some Noonie cookie?
Yeah.
Don't you want him to, you know, go down on you and stuff like the good old days?
You remember?
Yeah, suck it now. Okay, that was the 60s. Damn. I mean, I'm just saying.
It's time.
It's time for you to step down. And take Pence with you if you can get that if you can get that fly off his head. And you need to go. You've got to go. You've got to go before you destroy some old shit. Because this is too much.
Yeah.
It's too much. And it's not me being mean to you. It's just me being honest. You like, what, 70, 80? Was she 80 something?
Sure, I think high 70s. I'm not kidding.
Okay, let's say high 70s. You know, man, you could go be make your make your great grandchildren some
cookies.
Go make
some cookies, yes. Yeah,
and some goulash.
Enjoy your life.
Enjoy your life. You got all the money in the world.
Yeah.
How much money do you need? And I'd ask Trump the same thing. How much money do you need?
Yeah. I think it's ego with him more than anything else.
You can only, you got so much money, your great grandchildren, your great great grandchildren will be rich.
Yeah.
So why not?
Yeah.
Do something.
Enjoy your life.
Why don't you do something humanitarian?
Yep.
Why don't you remember those that those buildings you were gonna build and fix the infrastructure?
Yeah.
Why don't you build some homes for the underprivileged? And underprivileged could be poor white, poor Latino, poor black, poor anybody.
Yep.
Why don't you do something for the
Pablo
for
Escobar
the Lord?
Did. I mean, even he, the most evil man on the planet, still built stuff for the people.
I mean, Bill Gates, that's not, you know, somebody gonna get him. You know, see, you know what, let me just say this.
You think he's responsible for a lot
I
of
think
things?
He's responsible for, when you have that kind of power, you start to believe your own bullshit.
Yeah, play God, huh?
And play God with other people's lives. But the funny thing is, there's only one God.
Yeah.
And the problem is with that is that since there's only one God. See, that's the, you know what? The problem is with America is that we profess to be this God-fearing country, but we've forgotten that God will place his wrath upon us. We've read the stories.
Oh, yeah.
We've read the stories.
We're getting there. We're getting to the point where we're so evil as a being that we'll be washed out like Noah's Ark again.
The Bible. I keep my Bible with me. You read the stories. You know Moses. Moses went to Pharaoh and said, and think about it. Moses was the prince of Egypt until somebody found out he was a Jew.
Yeah.
And then, okay. Now imagine this. Imagine you were prince of Egypt. You had a speech impediment, but didn't bother nobody. But the minute you realize I'm a Jew, I got to go be with my people. And God spoke to Moses. He said, go back and, you know, Pharaoh did his little nasty shit because Pharaoh was always jealous. Imagine going back to the same place you were once beloved by everybody.
Mm-hmm.
And people going, look at look at Moses coming up in here and shit, you know.
Yeah.
Imagine that. And then you speak, and I mean, Moses told God, he go, you know, I can't speak. He said, I'm sending Aaron with you. Your brother Aaron gonna help you get it together. He said, God said, let his people go. In the Bible it says God hardened Pharaoh's heart. That means he made it where he couldn't listen. He couldn't hear. He wouldn't hear, as it were. That's Trump.
Yeah.
That's Trump. That's Bill Gates. That's all them wealthy motherfuckers that don't give a damn about nobody else but their own greed.
Mm-hmm.
And how much money do you need?
Yeah, seriously.
How many billions do you need? What are you buying? You can go on space. You can go, you know what? You know why people going to the moon? Because niggas can't afford to go. They don't want us to go. They don't want, say, you know what? Let's go to Venus and them bitches ain't going to show up. I bet you they won't show up. Because they scared. Because white people say black people scared. They ain't going to show up in Venus. But if we go to the moon, they might show up. But that's go to Venus.
Yeah.
You can go wherever you want to.
You think we're eventually going to destroy the planet to the point where we're going to have
to live somewhere
else?
Other planets are going to destroy us. I believe that God is going to show himself. And he's going to show all of his creation. And we're going to find out that there's little red men from Venus and Saturn. And they don't like us. And they think we're nothing. And
they want our planet for our resources.
They might not even want this. They might burn it down and say, you know what? Y'all some nasty bastards. Oh, we just are. Can't. Because look what you did to the planet. Look at this nasty, nasty. Yeah. You know, and you have to look at it that way. You have to look at it from a point of, if the other planets came, what if the other planets came down? I saw a movie with Michael Rennie in it. And he was from another planet. And he spoke to America and said, you know, you fight amongst yourself over petty stuff. And he was telling American human beings this stuff. And you know them jackass shot him? So, I mean, you know, don't you come down here and tell us about ourselves. Yeah. You know? No, but just think about that.
Oh, it's awful. You know how easy it would be and how great the world would be if we were just all cool to each other?
Imagine. I remember my mama. And by the way, if you're listening, I grew up in the South. So my mother, I wish I was the Christian my mother was. I really do, because sometimes I think of some of the meanest things to do. Ooh, you don't even know.
Yeah.
But I wish I was the Christian my mother was. And I'm going to tell you why. Because next door to us was a young family. And they happened to be white, no problem. The young girl that was married to the guy, her husband worked at Dairy Queen. And she had a little girl. The little girl couldn't have been about 3, maybe. And she came up and said, Ms. Vera, can I use your phone? And she said, come on in. Because we lived in this trailer and stuff too, you know. So we get up there and the little girl smells my mama frying chicken. And she says, I'm hungry. And my mother says, you hungry, baby? She's a little kid.
Mm-hmm.
She said, let me get you some chicken then. And I remember she gave her a drumstick and I guess some other little sides, I don't know. And she said, ma'am, you don't have to. She said, the baby's hungry. Are you hungry? She had to stop and think, was she hungry? Was her pride greater than her hunger? So my mama gave her a piece of chicken too. So they were eating it. So she had called her husband and he knocked on the door and there he was. Okay. They had relaxed enough that time had lapsed and he finally came. He said, what you doing over here? She said, oh, we were just talking. And the baby had finished. And they gave me chicken, you know, my mother. And she said, well, I think, thank y'all for letting us use the phone, and y'all better get on home. I bought y'all something, you know, groceries or something. And I saw this evil look in his face.
He was mad?
He was mad. And I said, mommy, I said, why is he so mad? She said, oh, he's just shame. He's shamed that a black woman provided for his family to eat.
Huh.
And sometimes white folk get shame because they believe that they're better than them. When white people believe that they're better than you and you do something better than them, they get shame. And that man was shamed.
Wow.
Instead, he couldn't. He felt like he wasn't providing for his family. All they ate was beans and rice.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. And she said, my daughter, and the one thing my mother said to me, she said, when you see somebody hungry, feed them. Regardless no matter what color they are, feed them.
Yeah.
Don't be like that. Don't be mean because they're mean and they're prideful. You do what God says.
Yeah.
When I was hungry, you fed me. When I was thirsty, you gave me drink. When I had no clothes, you gave me clothes. these are tenets that God says, and why people don't. I can't believe, and I'm guilty of this too sometimes, because I'm a hoarder, and I am. But I this year, and you can call him and check. This year, I'm going to give away a lot of clothes to battered women's shelters and to women who can't, that are big women that need some nice clothes. Yeah. I'm going to give them away, because I can only wear one outfit at a time. I can only wear right. one pair of shoes at a time.
Right.
And it's because sometimes with hoarders now, the hoarders are different from selfish motherfuckers. Write that down. I hope y'all are writing that down. Hoarders are different from selfish motherfuckers. Selfish people don't want you to have nothing. They don't want you to have a damn thing. They'd rather you starve. Remember in the Bible, we talked about the rich man and the poor man. And the poor man asked the rich man for some of the crumbs off of his table. And what did the rich man do? He swept them and gave them to the dog. Hmm. Rather than give him the crumbs off the table, he swept, threw the crumbs and gave it to the dog.
Hmm.
Now, the rich man died. The poor man died too. But the poor man went to heaven.
Hmm.
And the rich man, he said, he's in hell. He said, Lord, let the poor man dip his fingers in the water and put it on my tongue. So cool my tongue. Yeah, right. So anyway, hoarders now.
Do you consider yourself truly a hoarder, or are you just being?
No, I can't help it. I got clothes. I got tags on. I need
is
to be
your house walkable?
Yes, it is walkable. I have stuff in storage and in my garage.
Okay.
That
program?
Yes, I know. My daughters have had a long talk with me, and all of my daughters, daughter-in-laws, have talked to me.
Oh, it's hard. I have one more question.
You can ask me anything you like.
Now,
my big mouth.
I know. It was not my intent for us to go down that lane. But what the next question for you, for me, is, and I always ask this for people because it's always different, is what was the best day of your life? Well, the best moment. You can think about it.
When I had. When I had my family. And it seemed perfect. In the beginning, it seemed perfect. And then when I got my TV show, those are the times.
Were you in a good space when you got your TV show, mentally?
I thought I was. I think I was. I think it was a lot of unknown unknowns.
Yeah. A lot of pressure too, right?
I sat when they took this, when we did the pilot. When I realized I could really, really do this, the pilot
must have been pretty good, right?
Yeah, I mean, the pilot was good and everything, but this is the part I watched them take the set down.
Oh.
And I sat there and I just kind of teared up.
It's heartbreaking, huh?
Because they were taking it apart.
Yeah.
And I go, well, I guess we'll see what they say. I don't know.
This is after the pilot.
After we filmed the pilot, They're taking the set down. And I'm just sitting in the bleachers looking. And it was just...
You know that doesn't happen for a lot of people.
I know. My mother told me, she said, do you know how many people wish that they have gone this far in their career? They haven't gone to the places you've gone to. They haven't seen what you've seen. They haven't done what you've done. You have nothing to be ashamed of. You have every right to be proud of yourself. And any man would be, what did she say? They would be lucky to have a woman like you. Well, why didn't you say that to Bill when I was married to him? Damn. Heifer. No, I'm just.
I mean, let's talk about that for a second, if you don't mind. I mean, is it just crazy pressure and stress, or is it blissful because you're actually there, or were you euphoric? Were you? I mean, it's such an incredible, because I have friends who have shot pilots, and some even got them picked up, but they weren't really about them per se.
What my show was about, my philosophy on child rearing, it wasn't about, it was a little bit about
your point
me.
Of view.
It was, people kept on saying, when are they going to let you be yourself? And I go, oh,
never.
If they let me be myself, honey, it's going to be a problem.
Yeah.
And I felt like, in a weird way, they should have taken a chance, because my children, my real life children, were funnier than the ones on TV.
Oh,
my children,
yeah. You could never capture the real lightning in the
bottle. That my children were funny. Yeah. My children were funny. And let me tell you something. I have seen them. And I said, I had to teach them how to fight. They didn't even know. Because Adam was the only child. Brendan was the only child. Brandy had a brother, but she said she never fought him. And Jason was the only child. You have to know how to fight like a sibling to have. Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Tooth and nail.
I said, this is what you do. I said, I'm sitting there going, really? None of you've never fought with your siblings? You don't have any. That's a good idea. Yeah, I picked a bunch of winners right here. Let me say something. You're gonna have to shove him. You're gonna have to shove him. That's what it's about.
Yeah.
Especially with boys. Shove him. The funniest one out of the group, Jason Weaver. Jason was funny. Brandy was supposed to be the chip off the old block. She was not. Jason was the chip off the old block. He was funny. He mischievous. His mother was mischievous. I was mischievous. And that he was... that boy, Jason was so funny. And I loved him. He will never know I loved him. I thought he was brilliant. And I wish my show had stayed longer. But it was, I don't do politics. And I don't kiss kids' ass. Mm. So that was a problem.
Yeah, what did happen ultimately? How many episodes did
I got
you do?
22.
Oh, is that
21,
22. Two seasons or three?
That's one season.
Wow, back then they ordered 22, huh?
Yeah, 21, 22, yeah.
Huh. Were you proud of them?
Yes. They could have been better if I had better directors.
It's also the first year. So
it was my first year. People kept on saying, well, why won't you hook us up? Okay, so I try to explain this, and I'm going to explain this on this podcast the best I can. Look here. When you go on your job, you get hired for a job, You just trying to hold on to what you got.
Job.
Okay? You trying to hold on to your job.
Yeah.
You can't come visit. You can't be asking your cousin if he want to come on. That is not how this works. You got to keep on. When you get the job and you stay on, say, now 2 years, 3 years, now you can kind of maneuver around.
Sure.
You can maneuver.
Yeah,
but
you're not calling those shots.
I can't do shit, and I just got there a month. What the hell? What you think this is?
Yeah,
you gonna fuck around and get me fired?
I run CBS.
You know, you act like I run ABC. I don't run shit. And then people stop being my friends. You could have got me on. You could have got me on as a writer. I will never forget this one writer. Said all this shit. She said she let me have it with both barrels. And let me have it with both.
But
barrels.
She was out of line, right?
She was out of line, bitch. Yeah. What can I do?
Yeah.
You could have did something. I called you. You called me. So what?
Yeah.
Bitch. and that's all I'm getting at. Yeah. Everybody don't get upset. I just cuss. Bitch, I just got the job. When you just get the job, you can't get nobody else a job. Well, you could have put me on the writing as a as a, what you call it?
And they know better too.
And she said that shit. She made it. And then another guy called me and he let me have it too.
Oh, gosh.
I said, oh my God, y'all were never my friends. That's what fucked me up the most.
Yeah.
You were never my friends. You, man, what?
Being at the top must be awful.
I wouldn't, I didn't feel like I was at the top.
No.
I felt like I was just, the first time I rode in a limousine by myself. I had tears in my eyes. Because it seemed like
proud?
Shit. No.
What kind of tears?
The kind of tears that you think somebody's supposed to be with you. But they flaked and they abandoned you. Just like everybody else.
So it even in the pinnacle of success, you felt...
Even though I'm making successful moves, I'm sitting in the
limo all alone, not enjoying it with anyone else.
I'm just by myself. And I'm realizing it. I'm by myself.
Sad moment.
Yeah, sad moment because... How could everybody be mad at me? I just got this job.
You didn't hook everyone up.
I was like, and then they said, you can do this for me. You can do this for me. You can do this for me. I can't even do anything for myself. Yeah. Let me get myself together. Myself together.
You'll hook everyone up as you can.
As I can, but they don't want to hear that.
I know.
Nobody wants to hear that. And so that's the sadness of it. And... then I was in the limo with my manager, Bernie Young, and he said, I said, you down forever? He said, down forever. I said, you'll stand by me? I'll stand by you. Not so much. He ended up being with Rosie O'Donnell, and I'm not mad.
Because he dropped you for her?
We were both with him.
Oh.
But Rosie needed him full time because she had the talk show. And he can't be me and her. So that's okay. So now I really realize I'm alone.
At that point? Uh-huh. When
I'm alone.
Bernie.
Now, I'm still riding in the limos and shit.
Yeah.
Doing talk shows and stuff like that. But the people that ride in the limousine.
Not always the happiest.
They're not for me. They're for themselves.
Right.
And I realized that. And that's a
Hollywood's a tough game to play, isn't it?
It's a bunch of barracudas out there.
Yeah.
I'm glad I left LA.
Any regrets?
That I met the people I met.
I mean, with what you didn't do or what you didn't...
I think I could have handled some things better.
Yeah.
Remember I told you I had a real bad temper?
Yeah.
Yeah, you know... I fight you about a pickle, yeah.
Yeah, but you're gonna claw your way.
You know, I said, do something. You know, somebody 6'4".
Yeah.
How hard it is for them to do something to somebody 5'3".
Right.
He would have got. If I had to bite his nuts, he would have known he was in a fight.
Uh-huh.
And I think that I could have. I wish I could have gotten in tune more with my God than I was. And
earlier in your
earlier
life.
And made people, let God maneuver the people
yeah.
to do what I want. Some things did get maneuvered by God, but then there's things that the flesh wants, what the flesh wants, and being in love with people who don't love you and
so hard.
And none of them love you. If I did the math, I would say none of them love me. None of them. They were there for what they could get.
That's terrible.
Yeah, it's terrible.
That's manipulation.
No, that's manipulation. That's true. But it's the truth.
Yeah.
It's the truth. None of them were there for me. They were there for what they could get.
An awful way to experience relationships.
You know what? And it taught me a learning lesson. I taught my daughter something. You're so much more than them. You don't need them. And I recently talked to one of my exes, and he's talking about, you need to come back to L.A.
Yeah.
Yeah, so they can put you in a cab.
I'll visit,
now,
but
I'm
not
coming to L.A. Yeah. There's not. I said, love can't make me come back.
Money probably can't either.
I know. Because you know why?
Sanity is way more important.
Sanity is way more important. And you're going to make... I know you, and I know how you think, and I know how you feel, and that's the problem. You don't feel.
They don't care.
You don't care about me.
Nope.
You care what you can get from me.
Yeah.
And that's what women have to learn. And that's how women in Hollywood get done.
They need to know that right up front. Yeah.
Phyllis Hyman killed herself because she was lonely.
In Hollywood.
And yeah.
Oh, God.
She was
terrible.
In New York when she killed herself. And she was making like $30,000 a week.
Doing like on a sitcom?
Singing. She was a singer. Listen to Phyllis Hyman. I want y'all to look her up and listen to her voice. It is probably one of the most pristine voices you will ever hear.
Angelic.
Even Nancy Wilson said her voice was amazing. It was exquisite. She was a diva. And let me tell you something. If you hear, I Can't Stand This Living All Alone.
Yeah,
and Betcha by Golly Wow.
Did she write that herself?
I Can't Stand This Living All Alone. I think Norman Connors wrote it. But you listen to...
She probably sang the hell
out of it. And her voice was amazing. And I just want everybody to if you ever heard of her or knew her, her voice was this most amazing. None of this Beyonce and stuff and Rihanna, none of that, none of that, none
soulful,
of that.
Soulful, right?
It was came from her soul where her voice sang. And I mean, notes are so pristine. It's nothing fake about her voice. And they should strive to try to get a voice like that. And
I think those voices are given by God very infrequently.
I mean, even Jill Scott's voice is beautiful. Nina Simone. See, this is what these young girls don't get. Nina Simone didn't sound like Nancy Wilson. Nancy Wilson didn't sound like Etta James. Etta James didn't sound like Phyllis Hyman. I mean, every woman's voice sounded different, and its own sound, and it meant something when they sang, and you wanted to hear them sing. The only person's voice that didn't mean that much is Diana Ross. I mean, she didn't have no soul. I mean, she has soul.
She had talent.
That's what she had. She had talent.
Right.
She have soul.
No,
that's a difference.
Huge difference.
There's a huge. Now, Jennifer Hudson. That's a soul.
That's soul.
She's soul. Oh my goodness.
She's
that's a soulful voice right there. But that's not to be dismissive of Jill Scott.
Right.
Jill Scott has different intonations, and if you listen to her, she can go almost from almost operatic to all the way. Now, Jennifer Hudson sang Nasum Dorma. But I know opera. Okay, now, but I would give anything to hear Aretha Franklin sing Nasum Dorma again. It was the most amazing thing she sang at the Grammys.
Yeah.
Because Pavarotti could not make it. He fell ill. And she had just sang it at the Congress, Congressional Hall.
Yeah.
But when she sang it at the Grammys,
blew
and she sang
water.
Just a little bit of the English of what it meant, it's the most amazing thing I've ever heard in my life.
Yeah.
Now Jennifer sang it, yeah. But Aretha Franklin sang it. And she had studied at Juilliard a little bit because she realized that she had sang all her life and she'd never studied at Juilliard. And she thought, hey, I should study at Juilliard. Now imagine, late in life, I'm gonna study at Juilliard. That's what I'm finna do. And she does it.
And at that point, she was already a legend, right?
She's already a legend. It don't mean nothing.
No, you always
learn. It's just her. It's just her. I wish I could learn Nasu Norma, but I smoke too many cigarettes.
Are you a singer?
Did you? Please. And there, when I was younger, I could sing, but not now. I smoke too many cigarettes now. Don't start asking me to sing songs.
I
ain't singing no songs for nobody. So don't start asking me that.
Swing love.
That's all I got. It's wait a minute. Are people on the laptop?
I don't have my laptop. I carry my equipment.
I'm curious to know what they think
of this.
Uh huh.
I mean, it was a phenomenal conversation. There's no denying.
No, I mean, I'm just saying. Do you get people that say, "Why is that bitch?"
No, what will happen is, you know, I'm all new at this too, but I'll upload it to like iTunes and
really,
yeah, include your name, and I'll give you a link, and people will listen. Hopefully, enjoy.
They probably think I'm crazy.
We're all crazy. If you're not crazy, you're an idiot. Well, I'm going to put your name up there. I want to thank you for doing it.
Oh, no problem.
I had a great conversation. We've talked many times at length, and I enjoy our conversations, and I think...
I just think that, for me, I'm just regular. I think I'm a regular chick.
Well...
You know who I really think is cute as a bug? I don't know if she's listening, but I think Cardi B is the cutest little fucker.
You like her?
I'm just a regular
chick. Yeah. She's killing it, too. She kills the game.
She kills it, and you know what? She deserves to. Yeah. You know what? They thought she was nothing, and she proved them wrong. And I'm always for the underdog.
She's got talent, and she's interesting.
She's been in movies, and I don't watch it often, but I watched Love and Hip Hop Atlanta. Now, I'm not going to say that Cardi B won't smack a bitch, because she will. But I watched it, and I said, isn't it odd that Jocelyn, who's with Stevie J, ain't done half of the shit that Cardi B has. You need to be quiet. That's what you need to be. Yeah, big cup of shut the fuck up.
Yeah.
And, because I feel like, you know, I love Cardi B. She's amazing to me.
Do you like her music?
Not all of it, but I just think she's amazing.
You like as a person, as a character,
I think she is amazing, and I think I wish her all the best, and I hope she and her husband, if they can stay together.
Yeah, they've had on and off, right?
Yeah, they're kind of It's like you have to work in marriage.
Yeah.
Work at it. Sometimes it ain't perfect. Sometimes he get on your nerves.
Yeah.
Sometimes he say shit he ain't got no business saying.
Right. She's very generous with him, too. I've seen videos of her giving him stacks of cash, cars.
Now that's when I draw the line. Well, I'm not giving no man no stacks of cash.
He may be laying some pipe that she needs.
That ain't that much pipe in. I don't give a damn. Your dick is big as the Alaskan pipeline. You can keep that dick to yourself.
Maybe size. Maybe he's working it right. I mean... She couldn't be away from him for months. They got back together after some shit, and who knows?
Sometimes.
Yeah. Yeah. True.
And then sometimes the person you love is the worst person.
I know. Love is tricky. Well, you just told me that most of your loves have been through someone wanting something from you. Yeah.
I mean, and then tell the story wrong.
Yeah. Well,
that's
you're never going to tell the truth. Yeah.
Because you wouldn't shit.
Right.
Wouldn't shit. Write it down.
I wish you, it's genuinely and sincerely, I wish you true love someday.
I'm 65.
It doesn't matter. My uncle got married at 65 for the first time, and he's very happy. Who? Go ahead. Trace Atkins. Oh, really? Oh, you like the big guys? Have you ever met him? Talked to him? Or? You got look at getting all giddy about him over here.
I can't.
Really?
I don't even know.
Have you ever liked a country singer?
I've been an acquaintance of one.
Okay.
Willie Nelson.
Are you a country music fan?
Some of it. Willie Nelson.
Willie Nelson.
It was fun.
I bet.
He said, I heard
did you open
you.
For him?
I heard about you.
Yeah, everyone's heard about him.
Yeah. And then we smoked some weed and we laughed and talked. And that's the nicest man I've ever met. And me and my girlfriend, we were sitting backstage. We were on the stage.
Yeah.
And all these floozies.
Right.
In Anaheim. And all these floozies couldn't figure out how we got back there. Bitch,
talent.
Yeah.
No. We talented.
He's smiling and grinning at us. And we just looking at each other and busting out, man.
Loving
we
it.
We had one.
Yeah.
Actually, it was the best time.
How did it all happen? Were you opening for him or were you just, no, did you get?
Told Willie Nelson, I like he said, well, Willie Nelson's going to be in Anaheim. He said, we'll leave a ticket there for you. And it
hold
was
on.
Wrong.
You accidentally shut it off. Start okay. The story again.
Okay. It started with Tom Hester. He's a comedian out of Houston. Well, he lives, his family's rich, and they live not too far from Willie Nelson in Austin. Well, he tells Willie Nelson's he's friends with her, with his daughter, and we talk. And he tells them about us. Da, 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 da. Willie Nelson is going to Anaheim. So Tom calls us and tells us, what y'all doing? I said, none. Not going. Well, you going? Well, we're in Anaheim. I said, yeah. And Willie Nelson wants to meet you.
Well,
okay.
Yeah.
Okay, I'll go. Okay, so we get there, me and my girlfriend, and we get up there, and we knock on the bus, and Tom is waiting for us. He goes, he's waiting for you. And I go, see, I'm not no respecter of persons. So I'm like, okay, whatever. So I get on the bus, and he goes, I've heard about you. And I said, I've heard about you. And he's eating hemp cereal. Now, you know damn well, hemp cereal tastes like Grape Nubs. Who the fuck want to eat that? So then we head up there. And we smoke a joint, a couple. And he is the coolest fucking guy I've ever met. Now, he is the coolest. Now, who else would I like to smoke with? Snoop.
I was just going to say, he comes to the comedy store sometimes.
I would love for him. I'd love to smoke. I saw Dr. Dre, he was sitting on top. I said, let me tell you something, Dre. You and your little gang need to stop acting like y'all invented weed. I was smoking weed when you was a dream in your daddy's nuts. I don't know what the fuck y'all think you running. And so I said, I told Warren G the same thing.
Snoop Dogg, did you see him in the Super Bowl?
I loved him.
He looked great.
I loved him.
Did you see him dance? He looked great.
He looked great. And I feel like I still love Snoop.
Oh, yeah.
He is still legend. The Miles Davis of rap to
yeah,
me.
He's a legend.
I love Snoop. I think he's the most bestest.
So glad he didn't get killed off like some of the other rappers, which was a huge tragedy.
He left Death Row. Because he saw the signs.
Good, smart.
He Suge was not a good man.
Yeah. Well,
he was evil. And he
took out two of the best.
And he took two of the most brilliant geniuses out. And why would you do that? What was the reason? Jealousy.
Money,
jealousy. Well, now, where's the money? Because you don't own the catalog anymore. Because no. Safari Afeni owns the catalog, and Mrs. What's his name?
Biggie Smalls.
Biggie Smalls' mama, she owns it, and
Wallace.
You ain't getting it.
Yeah, Not from her, you know.
You're not getting it, P.
You
Diddy.
Took his son.
P. Diddy has something to do with that. I don't believe the two biggest.
Yeah. I remember that.
They had some, and P. Diddy can stop pretending.
You
did something. You had something to do with it. But I just can't believe that they would. Wouldn't it be something, though, if Tupac was really alive?
Well, it would be great if they were both alive. Let's be honest.
It would be like that. Then that would make Elvis have to live. Damn it. Yeah. No, anyway.
But Notorious B.I.G., or whatever you want to call him, he was awesome.
He was very awesome. And I think that's why Lil' Kim lost her mind briefly. Because, I don't know if you've noticed, she's gotten real light. And
she losing pigment over him?
I'm sorry. That's so not funny. That's not right.
I'm sorry.
No, that's okay. She wasn't dying her skin. That's the thing with black women.
Well, they try to get light skinned?
They're bleaching their skin.
Really?
Yeah, they are.
Oh, be
and they're
proud
doing it in
that.
Jamaica, too.
In Jamaica?
Yeah, that's and like white ironic. Boys is trying to get that dark skin beauty. And these motherfuckers is trying to be Asian. I don't know.
I think black women are beautiful. I think the skin color on Colombians, black people, even some Mexicans, the olive skin, it's all beautiful.
But
we got to stop with it.
I don't know. But I don't know what's driving this where you want to bleach your skin. I don't get it.
Well, Michael Jackson did.
Well, you know, that motherfucker went bananas. I guess he was jealous because Prince was already that color. Yeah, and just, exactly. You know what? Let me tell you something. They say Michael was so jealous of Prince, and I don't understand, but I have to get more documentation on it to know if it's true. Now, imagine it's two geniuses.
Yeah.
Okay, but Mozart was jealous. Scolari was jealous of Mozart because he was a genius.
Yeah.
And he was jealous of him because Mozart didn't care about being a genius.
Exactly. That's what made him a genius,
partially. This motherfucker. He's a genius.
He don't give a fuck.
He over here playing Twinkle Twinkle with one toe.
It's like Goodwill Hunting with the professor.
It's just some people
just have it.
They don't. It's not that they don't care about it. It's just that it comes to be
so natural.
A part of fun. That's part of them.
Yeah.
And instead of being egotistical, it's not in their nature.
Yeah.
So they just dig the fuck what they do.
Yeah.
And you're making it be some shit it doesn't even have to be.
Some competitive. That's the thing I always said is when I used to go on the road at the beginning, I always made friends with the comics and really got to know them and like them and thought they were lifelong friends. But as soon as I got to L.A., that relationship became competitive and shitty.
Let me tell you something. I done took in comics before, and they've acted
a fool.
And don't ever do that. Don't ever do that.
Yeah.
You can do it from a place, a spirit led, but always be mindful that they don't feel the same way.
No, that's terrible. Because comics, there should be a brotherhood or sisterhood or some kind of hood.
It used to be.
Oh, really?
In the 80s, it used to be.
But they had the Kinnison Dice squabble. Everyone seems to.
Okay, this is the deal. Let me tell you something about Dice. Kinnison was who Kinnison was. He used to be a minister. Okay, a kid minister. Okay, fine. Fuck that. Now, Dice, if I'm not mistaken, and you could get a phone call saying I am, but Dice had this persona that spoke to New York Italian men. And he was riding that train so high. And it was working for him. I mean, you don't fill up Madison Square Garden twice if this shit ain't working.
Yeah.
It's working. Okay? Let me tell you where it went wrong. He was going to be on Saturday Night Live. And the women on Saturday Night Live said they weren't going to do the show if he was going to be on it. And in his mind, I guess he thought, surely they know this is just a character. this isn't real. This is not who I am.
Right.
He went on Arsenio Hall.
Yeah, I was just going to say.
And broke character. Not only did he break character, but his tears came out of
him. Yeah.
He started to cry a little bit. And I said to myself, I wouldn't give them bitches that satisfied. I could give two fucks about how your feelings were. Let me tell you something. You knew from the jump that that's not who he is. Hell, he's Jewish. Quit playing with me.
Right.
Stop being stupid.
It's a character.
It's a character. He don't look mean at the, no harm.
Look at the jacket. The fucking...
Who you know? I mean...
The beads. The name. I mean, come on.
So I said... Which bitch? It's just a joke, you jackass. So it hurt my feelings to see him cry on our set.
Yeah.
Because he didn't have to.
Yeah.
He had none to defend. He was
If he doubled down, he probably would have been a hero, no?
Yeah, really. He had to double down.
Yeah.
And just kept it up and not.
And then had the last laugh at the end. But
his feelings would show that he had feelings that they would think.
Jewish, probably raised right.
I mean, you know, you knew it was a joke. We all knew it was a joke.
Mm-hmm.
It wasn't even real.
No.
It was just fucking around.
He even said, wasn't it a mixture of like Vinnie Barbarino, you know, the Fonz and.
I mean, it was just a joke.
Yeah.
Quit being a dick.
Yeah. Well, that's what this country do. Take something.
And the women they were narrative. Serious. If he's on, we're off. Well, bye, bitches. Bye. And I would have said that. Bye, bitches.
Did he ever get... was he actually on it? Or did they get him canceled?
I don't know if... I want to say he was on it. But I want to remember that he had the right to be on it. More than anything else, he had the right to be
superstar at the time.
He's a superstar. He's filled up Madison Square Garden. He has the right to be on that show.
Yeah.
And y'all made an ass about it.
Yeah.
And he didn't even do nothing. It was a character. It was God playful. Damn. Rosanna Dana was a character. I could easily say, I'm tired of stupid bitches being on TV. But yeah. I didn't say that. Did I? Did I say that? No, I didn't. I like Roseanne Rodana. And let me tell you something. I could easily say with Chevy Chase, I didn't like what you did with Richard Pryor. Now, I don't want to watch it unless he gets off. Was bullshit. It was all just fun and bullshit. And you made it be something dirty that it didn't have to be.
Yeah.
And now... You know,
that's how our culture is now. Even worse now than then.
You know what? Let me tell you something.
I want an apology.
I bet you won't get one.
Yeah.
I bet you better pray on it. Now, I ain't gonna lie to you. When they had Martin on there,
yeah.
I thought that was funny.
Well, was that when he passed out from preparing for a movie?
No, not that's when he was cussing.
You're talking about Martin Lawrence, right?
Martin Lawrence was on Saturday Night Live. That shit was funny. I'm sorry. He's
a hilarious guy.
He is, and you knew he was going to cuss. You knew it. That's who he was. Yeah. What do you want?
Don't they have like a 30-second delay where they can bleep that stuff?
I don't know what they did, but I know that.
He's funny, and he's smart.
It turned out they were all mad about it and stuff. It's like, you know what? You knew he wasn't clean comic. He never was a clean comic.
No.
So why are you making horse's ass out yourself?
Well,
now?
That's why these shows this week is like, I'm not a clean comic. It's like, sorry.
No. You know what?
I'm doing my best.
Not Bernie Young. Roger taught me what to do.
Roger Paul? Mm-hmm. What did he say?
He said, Thea, tell them about your life as a kid. Tell them. And I do. I got expelled in the second grade. Who does that? Me.
Second grade?
Yeah.
What did you do it as a second grader?
I told you on stage. Were you there?
Maybe. Where was it?
I went to Catholic school. I drew a picture, a stick figure of a man with three legs. And Yeah, because I thought that was the right thing to do. That's I was scribbling, fucker. I was scribbling. Yeah. So I mean, you know, fuck you. I did. I scribbled that. I just can't believe it. And I got an ass whooping for it. Because I deserved it. I had no business doing that in the first place. But I was scribbling. I didn't know that bitch was behind me. You know, the nun. And I have gotten so much trouble before. Fighting, doing stuff I don't have no business doing. You turned out good, though. I didn't turn out too bad. Yeah. I didn't turn out too bad.
You're good people. I've met a lot of comics in my time. Some I've loved, some I've... like we discussed, I'd want nothing to do with. And
you at first, the ones that you think that you want to be bothered with, they fool you.
Yeah.
They're in disguise. and then you meet
fake likable.
And then you get these other motherfuckers, you know, like, oh my God, I just can't stand you. And so to me now, at this point in my life, I'm just grateful to be able to tell jokes.
Yeah, you do it well. I like watching your stuff. I'm a dirty comic, and I appreciate.
You know what? I mean, they can get mad if they want to some shit. You can get mad if you want to, but I still said it.
And you know what?
It's probably truthful.
So deal with it.
You know, some of you are sitting up here. You know, looking ridiculous. Now, tonight I got to tell the story about the porn star. And, because people get all sensitive and shit about stuff I say. You know, they get mad.
It's a dirty show. You do your thing.
You shaving the hair off your nuts and you mad at me because I said that's gross. And it is fucking gross. And you should stop doing it. It's an embarrassment to all men. Mankind.
All mankind.
It's just disgusting. It's just, I mean, it's like, I can't even suck that. And yesterday I tell a woman about how to suck a man's dick. And it's just, it was like.
On the boat? You had the
she asked me. I'm just like.
God.
I said, my sons have asked me not to demonstrate this on stage. So I'm not going to. But I'm going to tell you what you need to do. I said, but it's so gross. It's so gross. I go, he's your husband. And he goes, she'll never want to suck my dick. But the way he acts, I can see why. It's like, you have to desire to, I said, you have to desire to put a man's penis in your mouth.
Yeah.
And it is a place of power. So, I mean, if you do it well, many good things can happen.
Many.
So,
I can confirm.
That's how you get a Benz. So, I'm just saying. and we talked about why she doesn't like it and why she has a fear of it and all of this. And I just went.
It's like you're a sex therapist up there.
People can come up to me and ask me anything.
Sure. Open book.
You can come
right?
and ask me anything you like, but be sure you can take what the answer is.
Right.
Don't come up here asking me questions. And then you don't like what I say.
And then be offended by the answer.
Oh my God, I can't believe you said that. Well, bitch, I did. Lucky you.
Yeah. Stop asking dumb questions.
I'm grateful to tomorrow. You got to get up at 6.
6:30, I have to get off the ship.
And they
did you
get,
know that?
I get off at 8, they say.
Oh, yeah.
Because my ticket is at 9. I mean, my ticket is at 1.
Oh, your flight?
My flight is at 1.
I may stay in town.
You're staying?
I may stay in town.
Okay.
Yeah, I don't.
But you know you got to get out the room.
Oh no, I have my friend owns a hotel room in Miami.
No. I'm talking about you got to get out the room here because
I know.
You got to
trust
give
me. I know.
Ticket.
Now
this is how cold blooded. You got to give him this ticket back because it's so important.
Yeah, I know.
That's the craziest shit.
All right, let's wrap this up. First of all, thank you very much. You're very cool. I love you. I hope we stay friends. I know we're new, but I genuinely
thank
you
for the cake and the coffee. I felt really good about that. Thank you.
It's absolutely amazing. Was the cheesecake good? Because it looked.
The cheesecake is yummy.
It was good?
I didn't want to leave. I have a thing where I don't want to leave the room sometime, and I just don't feel like going to what my knees don't want to act right. So I come down there and I haven't had my cigarette, so I'm gonna go.
Let's go have one.
Okay, well, let me go to the bathroom.
Okay, that's another episode of Come On Guy with Thea, and we're wrapping up. Good night, everyone.
Bye.